Hi, this is Gary and Namie. The webinar today is about what families and friends need to know about their loved one being bullied at work. So in a way, it's a letter from the bullied targets to family and friends. Please understand I'm bullied at work. And only through that understanding can you be compassionate and helpful in a good way and in a right way that's going to be very, very needed. If not now, very, very soon. So I'm assuming you're sitting with the bullied target, the one who is bullied at work, and families gathered around. I'll try not to swear in case they're children. That'd be fine. Or friends. But hopefully you're viewing this together. And that way it'll have the greatest impact. We're here to enhance that understanding and also to send out a warning in case I don't hit it strongly enough. I want to warn all family members that you also are at risk. You're going through the bullying situation yourself. It's called vicarious experience. You're not the one getting pummeled at work, but it does trickle down to you very, very quickly once you start to understand more about the bullying and your target friend or family member tells you more about what they're going through. You too can suffer. The research is actually very, very clear on that. Let's begin with some terms and some roles here. Basically, in its simplest form, it's between two people. It's between the aggressor, the hyper-aggressive individual, the violator, if there's a policy, the offender, the bad guy or gal, or the perpetrator. Simply put, bullies. And so there's a bully at the very least. There can be more than one bully. And what'll happen, I have to explain, as soon as an individual bully decides to hate your loved one, and that's what we're going to call your bullied target in your life, your loved one, your LO. So when they decide to target your LO, you see, target, we'll call them targets, not victims, because victims connotes, to call them victim is to suggest that they're somehow trapped in permanent purgatory. But there will be an ending to the bullying, and it sometimes can take years and sometimes weeks and months. But it will end, and there will be life for you and your bullied target after bullying. So it will end. But in its simplest form, there's one perpetrator and one target. Usually there's one target at a time. But I got to tell you that once a bully has decided to launch a systematic campaign of destruction at your loved one, targeting your loved one, several other people will sign up. Involuntarily sometimes. They don't even know they're doing it, but they become accomplices. And sometimes, at the invitation of the bully, they become explicit, clear accomplices. So they're also criminals, without a doubt. So there you have it. Usually multiple bullies and many of them ganging up in your target. Workplace bullying itself is a British term coined from a book published by Andre Adams and Neil Crawford in 1992. But the original Scandinavian term in the late 80s was mobbing, connoting that there were many, many, many bullies and perpetrators. So have it your way. They're the same phenomenon, mobbing and bullying. But it always starts with a single instigator coming up with an idea and then somehow as a puppet master behind the scenes orchestrating this assault, without a doubt. Now, we're talking about adult bullying here, not playground bullying. And so this is only between and among adults. But I want to couch it right now in terms of making it a very, very serious topic so that it can't be treated lightly as if this is something that happens only to children. This is workplace violence. Bullying is a form of violence. It's a form of abuse. In fact, it's the only type of abuse that basically hasn't been negatively sanctioned by society. We haven't made it taboo. We've said no to child abuse and domestic violence and even bullying of kids in schools. We've said, now that's a form of violence and that needs to stop. But the non-physical forms of violence in the workplace are just considered routine and we are sloughing it off. We're discounting it and we're letting it happen. But believe you me, your loved one is subjected to violence. The harm comes from the severity of the violence directed at them, without a doubt. But it also comes from the duration of the violence directed against them. How long are they exposed? Our research shows it's an average of 22 months, but it's that repeated, relentless exposure that generates most of the stress. And they're not exposed to great things. They're exposed to being humiliated and intimidated and threatened, degraded, disrespected, dehumanized, and basically debunked. They are totally, totally untracked as a human being. They are not even given credit. They're treated with such contempt as to be an unequal human being to others. So they lose their humanity. They're robbed of their identity. And this repeated exposure is extremely stressful. More about stress in a minute, but don't take stress lightly. It is a physiological, full bore, physical body, full body function. And it is not just imagination at all. Your loved one never deserved it. You know that. But some people looking from the outside in prefer to blame targets, just as they prefer to blame rape victims, as they prefer to blame pretty much anybody except a child who's abused. Anybody who is abused in our society is typically discounted as someone who asked for it by virtue of their style or being different or how they dressed or the color of their skin, whatever. It all is that they deserved it. Well, that's pure crap. They don't deserve it. Nor was it ever invited. Your loved one never awoke on a particular work day morning and said, today's the day I deserve to be humiliated. I'm going to go in there. I'm going to really, really ask for it. That's total garbage. When this strikes a person of integrity, as your loved one is, a fully assembled adult with a completely formulated tried and true personality and a lifetime of experiences, and a marvelous work record, by the way, because that's usually who gets targeted, there is a tremendous amount of shame generated in that person. There's a little bit of guilt, sometimes that they let this happen to them, but they couldn't stop it when it happened because they were surprise attacked, they were ambushed. And they still can't believe, perhaps, that someone can be that cruel and be allowed to get away with it. Well, two facts. There are people that cruel, and two, most organizations allow bullies to get away with it, and that's disgusting. But the shame that is generated by these personalized assaults, I mean, they're being singled out from others in the work group for this kind of torment. And the original founder of the whole international movement had many, many synonyms for this, and social misery was one of them. So targeted for this social misery results in a lot of shame. More than guilt. And because of that shame, the personal shame, which is an assault on their character, a belief that they are somehow defective inside, they've let the lie come through that somehow they are less competent than they know themselves to be. That's going to make the person stay quiet. They're not going to come running home and tell you, they'll try and tell you good news, but they're not going to tell you the real story of what's happening in their workplace. I'll give you an example. It happened to me and my wife, Ruth. Dr. Ruth is the reason we started the whole U.S. movement. And she was working at a new clinic and doing work she was very familiar with, but at a new clinic with a new supervisor. And it was total living hell. And she didn't tell me for 4 months. There are a variety of reasons for that. It's coming up next. But she didn't tell me. I couldn't help her. And my first response when she told me 4 months later is, why did you wait? Well, that was the wrong response. So I don't want you to have that response too. With a little better understanding of this phenomenon, you'll understand the power of shame and the fact that it compels silence. It forces people to go underground. And so there's a great deal of shame. That's why they're not going to tell you. There's no doubt about it. Now let me show you what it actually looks like. There's a movie clip here that we want to show you. The film is titled Swimming with Sharks, a late 90s film starring Kevin Spacey as the bully. He's a 2-bit movie studio producer in a 2-bit movie studio, and he's just the worst of the worst, and he's getting a new male assistant named Frank Whaley, who's coming on board, and this is the young guy's first day on the job. And he's replacing Benicio del Toro, who you'll see very slightly in this clip. But he's the one that's going to take his job. He's going to be Kevin Spacey's right-hand man. So now let's run the clip, and we'll be right back on the other side. I just wanted to make a couple comments from the clip. First of all, the name calling, dog boy and the rest, is the most obvious, easiest to write off, and you can almost laugh at that kind of bullying. But the piercing, identity robbing kinds of things in the film, the hardest things that he did was when he turned to the young fellow and said he had no brain. I mean, that was an incredible personal attack, and it leveled the fellow. And then how he shut him down when it was time to laugh. So it was all about control. All bullying is about control. And Spacey was over the top. And then I guess the more disturbing, well, not more disturbing, equally disturbing thing is Spacey actually states what the fellow's job is, and that is to be his personal slave. And not to accomplish anything for the company, but rather be his personal slave. So it's fascinating in that regard. Great clip. And that's probably some form of what your loved one was exposed to, because it had many, many forms of bullying in there. It had showing off in a public setting. It had tearing the person's identity apart. It had the fake idea of a sort of a life cycle, a cycle of tearing the person down and then bringing him back up, saying, now look, if you do what I say, then you're going to be able to have anything you want, and end on a fake high note. It had name calling. It had discounting. It had, ha, you have, what does he know? The put down of his predecessor. So your bully target probably has one or more experiences like that to relate. And eventually you're going to need to hear what they were exposed to. So I just wanted to prepare you for that. Now, targets in the room. You may have been your own worst enemies in a couple of ways. What makes you a target is, well, let me give you the profile of a target. I don't have that slide for you, but it's your typically independent, and this is in rank order from a 2003 survey of ours. You're technically more proficient than the bully. You're better liked and more emotionally intelligent than the bully. You're the one who is more ethical and honest. You have whistleblower in you. Not everybody is a whistleblower who's bullied, but everybody who is a whistleblower is bullied. And you don't want to play political games. You are apolitical. You go to work, not to play games maneuvering other people around. So because from that, portrait of strength is why you were targeted. So what is your flaw? What is the problem? How is it that you were targeted? Well, it's simply the fact that when somebody came to you with this outrageous aggression, you were so taken aback by it, you fell back on your training, your upbringing, your morals, and your values, and you typically walked away. Partly because you were shell-shocked and you didn't have anything to say, clever to say, but it also so shattered your image and your expectation of how people were supposed to act at work. I mean, that no one would talk to you outside of work that way, and yet at work, if they're your boss, and most of the majority of bullying is from a boss, though this is also dished out by coworkers with great frequency, but most of it is by a boss, you really are powerless to fight back, so you walk away. So the people who become bully targets are the ones who turn their back to the bully. Unfortunately, that's when the bully sinks the claws in, and that's why it's going to take you a heck of a long time to get out of there. Most targets have to endure this for an average of 22 months before they can find a way out. There will be a way out, but it may cost you your job. So anyway, because you didn't have a snappy comeback, and we don't teach people snappy comebacks, because if you could have had a snappy comeback, you would have had one on the tip of your tongue, you would have used it, you would have leveled the bully would have hugged and loved you because of that aggression. Look at it this way, you took the higher moral road, you didn't counter aggression with aggression, you countered aggression with turning away. For a couple reasons. Number one, you're hoping that time will make it go away. You're hoping that maybe the bully will see the error of her or his ways and change. You're wishing for the wrong thing there, but that's okay. That's part of the understanding that we all need to have about what you were thinking. You're also not going to tell other people. You're going to wait to tell them. You want to give a more thoughtful account and all that. But all that does is delay your getting help from anybody else. And also because of the shame, you wait to tell. So you're using time to get distance, but the time is actually working against you because the longer you wait, the more the stress, the more the exposure to stress-related situations. So it becomes horrible. Then you try and convince yourself that it wasn't such a big deal, that what they're doing to you is more routine. And you know what? It could be routine in your workplace. And isn't that sad? Isn't that sad that that kind of abusive conduct is actually routine? But anyway, to sort of reduce your own cognitive dissonance, to make you feel better and rationalize it away, it's good to say, oh, it wasn't such a big deal, although it actually was. That's why you were shell-shocked. That's why you are now experiencing anxiety and some of you depression and some of the, in the worst cases, trauma. And it's very severe and it's abnormal and you didn't deserve it. But sometimes you convince yourself, oh, it wasn't such a big deal. Then by doing this and not telling the family, you actually were thinking that you were protecting them. I'm not going to tell them, which incidentally prevents them from being able to help you, but I'm not going to tell them because I need to protect them from this. This will be too upsetting to them. You might be mad that they're going to be mad or worried that they're going to be mad at you. And so family members, you can't be mad at them. It's not the appropriate response. They, even though they sometimes expect it, your loved one did nothing wrong to deserve this. So, you know, just understand that. Now, this slide, this list, is not to suggest that bully targets caused the bullying to happen. There will be those people out there who say it takes two to tango, you know. You got a pair. You got bullies and you got targets. And so there's responsibility on the part of the target. We've even had idiots go on TV and say, well, it's the personal responsibility of targets to defend themselves. Yes, if they could. And we say, if they could have, they would have. So shut up. The only people who get targeted are those who were unable to defend themselves in the immediate moment. Not out of weakness, but out of probably a higher moral value. And you were better than that, and you weren't going to lower yourself and climb into the gutter, down into the gutter with a bully, without a doubt. So, let's go on with some things your family and friends need to know about bullying. Number one, the pattern that the bullies follow. Some of it is extremely predictable, but I have to tell you, after taking thousands of calls over the years, and now the WBI office takes calls and we do coaching and all that. We hear every version of targeted misery there is out there. It seems like even though there are patterns to what bullies do, they are cruelly innovative and they seem to come up with unique little things. But the bully for your loved one will have a particular MO. In other words, they will settle on a particular tactic. They will either try and set up your loved one to fail. They will accuse them of being incompetent. Then they will sabotage them so they can't demonstrate their competence anymore. Now watch how this plays out. And I do invite you to go on the website, WBI website, and listen to my podcast on the typical bullying scenario for some more insight into this. But, okay, let's see. So your bully target is called incompetent by the bully. That's a lie. But your target is a respectful person and figures maybe there's a kernel of truth to that. So that starts some unraveling, plants a seed of doubt, don't you see? Then comes with repeated exposure, being told you're incompetent behind closed doors weekly. After several months, your loved one's emotion starts to crumble. And what'll happen is their emotional strength. And so they're going to be suffering debilitating anxiety pretty soon. And you may or may not have noticed that. But that's going to account for some strange behavior. But that anxiety is generated by the deliberate infliction of intimidating crap. I mean, they are being subjected to being ripped to shreds in these meetings. So The point is, the person, your bully target, is falling apart emotionally, but they're not necessarily telling you how it makes them feel. So what you need to know is more about the emotional impact and the pattern it follows. It generally goes from shame, self-doubt, self-blame, anxiety, clinical depression, all the way up to PTSD, post-traumatic stress disorder, on the emotional side. All because, and you say, well, PTSD is a war wound, for crying out loud. How can that be? Because it is traumatizing. It is your loved one's world, professional world, away from you has been shattered. And they don't know how to put the pieces back together. And it is extremely, extremely severe. So it's unwanted, uninvited assault. You know, there's a lot of research that compares the impact of sexual harassment to the impact of bullying. Well, bullying's not illegal yet. Sexual harassment is. And guess who has the stronger adverse mental health impact? Who suffers more? Well, it's the bullied target because it's legal. And people say, why don't you just buck it up? Why don't you just grow a thicker skin? Why don't you just bop that person in the nose and end this and move on? For God's sakes, why'd you let this happen? But that isn't how it happens. That's not how abuse happens. Abuse happens to the person who is exploited. And the person who is exploited never invites the exploitation, but they open the door and they can't close the door once it's in there. They're going to need your help. They're going to need the employer's help. They need coworker help. Coworkers have abandoned them. So in the end, they only have you, family and friends. You are the only one still loyal to them, depending upon how far into the bullying experience you and your family are. You're still the last to fall away, without a doubt. But coworkers have abandoned them very, very early on because they're all scared, without a doubt. They ostracize them. More about that in a second. And the power of that. But the MO that your bullied target, your loved one lives with, gets to be very predictable. Like, they might call them incompetent, and then pretty soon they lie about them on a performance appraisal. Then they videotape them and prove them to be less competent. By now, they're very anxious, and the camera's put on them by the idiot bully, and that increases pressure, and they're pretty much doomed to fail. They're set up to fail. And don't forget, as I said before, they're probably the bully's gone around and rallied the support of the coworkers, so that pretty much everyone has turned against your loved one by this time. And all of this is engineered. All of this is part of the MO of the bully. You also need to know that if you were to leave them now, if you were to abandon them now, the sense of betrayal is extremely powerful. We don't have an estimate of the number of bully targets who commit suicide, but we hear of the stories all the time, and a very, very small number become publicly known through media portrayals. But let me tell you this, in the newest, one of our new 2012 surveys, we asked bullied targets a couple questions, many questions about their health. And one of them was, have you contemplated suicide and did you have a plan? 29% had contemplated suicide. They had thought about it. They could see the reason for it. They could see a benefit in it to themselves. I think it's only 16% had a plan. But think about that. 16% planned how they would do it. Whether they shut all the windows in the garage and turn the car on or something, they had a plan. Or they had a weapon. They had a plan. A third of bully targets consider suicide. If your loved one has ever said, I should just kill myself, it needs to be treated seriously. People who threaten suicide need to be considered likely to commit suicide. So it's not a game. That's all part of getting mental health help for your loved one. And hopefully you still have the job, and hopefully you have some form of insurance. Unfortunately, most health insurance is still tied to employers. So when the bully convinces the employer to throw your loved one out on the street as is likely to do in 7 out of 10 cases, a third of bully targets leave the job because they are terminated on false accusations. A third are constructively discharged. 25%, 25% are terminated. 25% are thrown out, forced out. The conditions become so unbearable that the target quits. It looks like a voluntary quit, but it's not. It's a forced out quit. And people can be convinced of it, including unemployment adjusters and all the rest. But that's called constructive discharge. And then another 25% actually quit because they finally have had enough and they voluntarily leave to save their lives. So that's very, very, very important. So I say all this to say that if you have been driven to economic destitution because of bullying, it's very easy to sometimes feel that this relationship is no longer worth it and you're going to abandon your former loved one. We beg you to stay because there is going to be life after bullying, but you may not see that right now. But if you leave, you may be the only emotional support that the bully target has. So I'm asking on their behalf, if they've never asked you, to stay. Kind of interesting, in an old 2000 study, year 2000 study, we found that women's spouses and partners stayed longer than did the men's spouses and partners of the bully targets. So hang in there a little bit longer, men, will you? Just get a little bit more patience, but do that. Another key learning point that you have to, a key to your understanding is, you have to understand how distress, and that's what I'm talking about with stress. There's good stress, but we're talking about distress, which is no good aspect to it at all, is actually going to cause a whole bunch of diseases that are going to need medical attention. And you start with cardiovascular and gastrointestinal and immunological, sleep disorders. They can't sleep well anymore. They take longer to fall asleep, or they wake up shortly after falling asleep. So there's insomnia, that sleeplessness, the sleep disruption leads to fatigue. Fatigue leads to errors. Errors allow the bully to go ahead and bolster their claim that your loved one is incompetent, and it becomes a way to drive them out and terminate them on what appear to be objective criteria, but the truth is it's all because of the stress-related diseases. The final bullet on this page is very, very new to talk about, only because the technology is new. They're using MRI technology now to study how stress, prolonged exposure to stress, unremitting exposure to stress, which is what bullying does, affects the brain. And it actually affects the brain tissue. It affects the brain tissue by actually shrinking the volume itself. More about that in a second. But I just want you to know that stress, that is it's called psychosocial stress. When it's caused by another human being, that's psychosocial stress. That's a relationship. That's an aspect of the work environment outside of your loved one, external to the person, that gets transformed into physiological changes in the body because of the human stress response. And the brain is flooded with stress hormones when stressed. And it turns out that they actually devastate sections of the brain. And this is all just new stuff being discovered, and it's fascinating. When the brain changes, behavior changes. Behavioral changes follow. First, about ostracism. You know what? I'm going to go do it this way. This is a very, very complex slide talking about brain changes, brain shrinkage. It's called atrophy. And this is a brand new 2012 study published in the journal Biological Psychiatry. And it's way too complicated for us, and I'm only a social scientist. But let me just show you a couple pictures. These are three separate regions of the brain showing up in a functional MRI. And these are brains of people who have been subjected to what they called in the study cumulative traumatic life events. In other words, prolonged stress. And there are three areas, and don't worry about the names, but there's a prefrontal cortex area, the medial, and in the middle picture, anterior cingulate, and in the right-hand drawing, picture, image, MRI image, the right insula is involved. And it turns out that stress shrinks that area. They atrophies those three areas, small gray matter volume. In other words, the loss of brain tissue leads to a lost ability for that region of the brain to regulate what it's supposed to regulate. So when the medial prefrontal cortex shrinks, you're going to have less of an ability to regulate stress. When the anterior cingulate shrinks, they think it's going to lead to a greater vulnerability for addictions and depression. And when the right insula shrinks, they think you're going to be less able to regulate social relationships and anxiety, so that actually, and this is relevant, dear family members, that when the person needs you the most, when they are the most stressed, they will actually push you away when in fact they actually need you. So it's counterproductive for the person, without a doubt. Let me go back. On the social front, as I said before about abandonment, it's the research is very, very clear about ostracism and social exclusion, that when it's many against you, you lose much of your social identity. We are social animals. We need the approval of other people to continue to do what we do. When others send us signals that we are unacceptable, or we're screwing up, or we're no longer desirable, it's very, very crushing, because we're going to give them more credit than, and a heavier weight, their judgment will carry greater weight than our own self-evaluation. So we're likely to discount our own self-image and self-esteem and what's called self-efficacy and things like that when other people are giving us contrary information. They may be lying, but we're going to treat that much more heavily. Now, what's fascinating is there has also been functional MRI research of this phenomenon of social exclusion. It turns out that when you are cast out by the group, the brain experiences pain. The pathways that are triggered, the areas and regions of the brain that are triggered, are pain pathways and trauma pathways. So it's not that old stupid axiom of sticks and stones will break my bones, words never hurt, is total garbage. Words, hurtful words from other people, casting doubt on our own humanity, are probably the most damaging words that can be heard, and the brain knows it, and it's extremely stressful. We're going to move through this again, Dave. We're going to just erase this slide. Now, as I said, with brain changes, there's going to be accompanying changes in behavior. So I want you to be alert to some of these things. The number one factor that you probably noticed since your loved one has been bullied at work is their, when they have broken their silence and they're ready to tell, they can't stop telling. They are obsessed. They're obsessed over details. They'll give you a minute-by-minute blow of what happened at a meeting. They'll give you, and they'll repeat it over and over and over again. This obsession is because of the stress that's involved and the enormity, the impact on their professional life. It's very, very hard looking from the outside in to understand this obsession, but obsessiveness is part of what's called hypervigilance. So your loved one may be traumatized. They may be on the border of being experiencing trauma. If not full-blown PTSD, at least some form of trauma, which could be acute stress disorder or something else, you're going to need help from mental health professionals, not just to stop the obsessiveness and the obsession, which drives you crazy. Dear target, you got to know you're driving everybody crazy with your obsessiveness. But I know it's not getting fixed, and as long as the problem is not fixed and the stress is unremitting, the obsession lingers. But just know obsessiveness is part of it. Again, it's part of brain changes because of the narrowing of focus. There is there were some fascinating studies with rats showing that these highly stressed rats couldn't pay attention to anything else in their environment once they were stressed. They were stuck in a rut, like tunnel vision. And so the obsessed bully target is very much stuck in a rut. Which makes them relatively egocentric. They're clearly centered on themselves. There is an apparent inability to listen to other people. Now, it appears to you to be rude or unloving or uncaring, but this is a temporary state. If the person never listened to you, then you shouldn't have partnered with the bum, without a doubt. But if they had a marvelous ability to listen to you and now it's suddenly lost, you can safely attribute that to the stress they're experiencing from being bullied. There's no doubt about that. So it appears to be conscious and deliberate. It's not. All of these are automatic responses to changes in the body from the human stress response and the onset of stress-related diseases. We mentioned this before about sleep disruptions. There are huge studies, full nationwide studies in France, but I mean there are other studies too in the U.S. about sleep disruptions and bullying, and they're to be taken very, very seriously because the person could develop real problems falling asleep at work that endanger themselves or endanger others. But most the biggest threat, the thing you want to most avoid is having a person be so tired that they make errors, which then are used to provide the quote objective unquote record for their dismissal. They're going to sound paranoid. Remember before when I said the bully gets a lot of support from the others on the team, the co-workers, and how they betray the bully target? Well, that is truly a situation of many against one. And so they're really not paranoid. It's not an artificial feeling. It's a realistic thing, without a doubt. So there are many against them. But couple the delay in telling you with the growing unrecognized stress that time has allowed to happen as they've gotten more and more exposed to bullying, more incidents, more denigration. And then so when they finally blurt out stuff to you, they're not only obsessed, they sound crazy. They sound paranoid. They're not crazy. They are reacting to what has happened to them. I don't want to say it's a completely normal reaction, but it's a predictable reaction. Again, you want to make sure that your loved one gets some mental health help. A lot of bully targets tell us that there's a stigma to going to see a counselor. Well, you got to get them past that. They need to see a counselor, and you can go as a couple and see a counselor because of this impact on you too. But you're going to have to find a counselor who understands workplace issues. If they do not, they will be more harmful to you and your family than anybody else. When you give all your trust over to a counselor, and that person says, I don't care about the workplace. Let's talk about other things and talk about you two. Leave, because if they're not going to be sensitive to what actually triggered this tremendous amount of stress and trauma, they're ignorant and they're not going to be able to help you in a solution. They can't define the problem. They can't solve the problem. So find a world-weary, workplace-aware, politically astute counselor. Unfortunately, we can only send you to the ones who have been trained by us. And if you're lucky enough to live in those few areas across the country, we'll be glad to refer them to you. But for all the rest of it, you're going to have to test out your counselors to find the right one. The tinfoil hat crack here on this line is actually true. We get calls often from people who require serious attention. If this has happened to your loved one, by now you know that they really, really require serious psychological and medical attention, because unless this is reality, unfortunately in our heavy surveillance world with technology, we don't know what things are out there that allow stalking and the rest. But you will hear many, many stories of stalking, perhaps, from your bully target. Try and ferret the truth from the false. Separate the paranoia from the truth. And it'll be better for everybody in the family. Now, that bright, happy loved one is temporarily gone, hiding under a rock right now. Perhaps crawling between the sheets on the weekend and not being able to get out, feeling paralyzed. Clearly negative outlook, gloom and doom. It's not all happy thoughts now. But if the depression is not medically treated, because there have been changes in the neurotransmitters in the brain, and there's evidence of changes, structural changes in the brain from the stress, that this depression, which is called reactive depression because it was brought on by the workplace, it was brought on by a series of events, repeated events, need to be treated. And the stress needs to be erased and reversed so you can get your loved one back. And they can recover. But we often hear from targets who call us to say, yes, but I don't believe in medication. But there is a chemical imbalance in the brain with depression. It all deals with, so much of it deals now with structural changes from the flooding of the stress hormone cortisol in the brain and other what are called glucocorticoids, ACTH and cortisol, but also the neurotransmitter serotonin. So there's a chemical, physiological, physical underlying basis for this depression. It's not imaginary and it needs to be treated rather aggressively to get it reversed. The events need to change for the person. The work environment needs to improve. They need to get to safety. But chemically, they can be brought back quicker than just waiting on the healing to happen and the reversal of the brain tissue atrophy and the rest. So please encourage your bullied target, your loved one, to have an open mind to potential chemical solutions to chemical problems. Let's start summarizing things you can do. Something I forgot to mention in the very beginning was when your bully target finally says to the employer, usually at HR, human resources, or tries to tell the manager or the boss of the bully, and all of those are fruitless avenues for redress, I'll tell you that right now, that's not going to end it. But when they do finally tell somebody, they are rarely believed. They're rarely believed because what they describe happening to them sounds outrageous. So the first thing you can do is believe your loved one right from the start. It is outrageous. You know, to any reasonable person, what they're describing is crazy. The cruelty, the hostility, the abusiveness, the baseless degradation and all that. It makes no sense. It serves no business purpose. It has nothing to do with work and everything to do with the bully's little insecure habits and proclivities and need to control other people. But it doesn't sound outrageous to employers, and it doesn't sound outrageous to the courts in lawsuits. The number one thing you can do, the support you can give that nobody else gives them, is to believe what they say. We are often asked, well, how do you know a target's not lying? Nobody lies about being so emotionally paralyzed that they can't live a full life anymore. You lie about sex is too great and you look too good and you have too much damn hair. That's what people lie about, but they don't lie about being bullied. That's for sure. Second point. It's a gift. Be selfless. Focus on your loved one. Give them the time they need. When they obsess, listen. Maybe you can get them to clip it short and guide them, and a good listener, be a good active listener and get them to conclusions in their story quicker. But the focus is still on them. It's a gift to them. You're listening to listen to them. You're listening to clarify their experience. You're not listening. You're not fake listening. Only rehearsing what you're going to say. So there's that. You're going to give them a lot of time. You're going to give them a lot of your energy. You're going to give them your ideas and your brain give them everything now. You can collect the credits later. It's like, Bill, if you're the kind of person who thinks in terms of exchanges and marketplace ideas, then you can cash in your chips later. They're just building up debt, and you'll collect later, but don't take your pound of flesh out of them until they've recovered from bullying. But then they'll owe you. And listen to me, bully target, you will owe your loved ones for hanging in there and your friends, because they were there at a time when you needed them most, and others have abandoned you. So, but it's deferred credit. It's deferred payment. Make sense? Another factor, another step you can take that really only family and friends can do, is to remind them of who they were before the bullying. You see, the bullies tried to convince them, and the worst bullies have crawled inside targets' heads to redefine their identity. I know it sounds crazy, and it is outlandish. To me, it's the most shameless thing another human being can do, to dare to get inside someone else's head to redefine their self-identity, to assault their personal record and redefine their successes as failures. But family and friends can say that's total BS. Here's what you were. Here's the record. Here's why I married you. Here's why I moved in with you. Here's why we have a life together. Here's why you're valuable. Here's where you're loved and everything else. And that record is owned by you, the bully target, and your family, and not the idiot at work who's trying to redefine reality. Lastly, I think one of the another important thing you can do is to distract your loved one. You distract them. You shut off the obsessiveness by distracting them with fun tasks, with family things. You don't let them crawl between the sheets. You don't let them go on and on and on. You don't let them emotionally shut down. You don't let them, you can't stop them from getting depressed, but you try and block it. You crowd out the bad with good events, with positive things, and you distract them. That's it. You will have your own unique ways and traditions in your family to distract your loved one, but do it. Don't buy into the emotional shutdown and let it happen all the time. Now, if they fight you, and the bully target may be arguing, though, if I just sleep some more, I'll feel better. After they've literally caught up with sleep and still don't feel better, you can say to them, all right, that's not going to work. We're off on a field trip. We're going fishing. We're doing this. We're doing that. And things that you loved together, without a doubt. Our advice when we're coaching bully targets is actually very, very similar. We say that while the person is home on leave, that and it should be disability leave, never workers' compensation leave, never unpaid leave for while a workers' comp claim is filed, but always disability leave filed by your physician, your family physician. Then while the person's home, they need to be distracted by documenting the costs associated with the bullying for the company's sake. In other words, they need to figure out, they need to affix dollars and cents to what the bully's been doing and how expensive it is in terms of turnover and in terms of absenteeism. Take the hourly rate of every person who has taken a mental health day or week or month and burned all their paid time off and even beyond, because you're bullied. Your loved one is probably already burned more than their paid time off and taken unpaid time off. They could call it FMLA, family medical leave, unpaid, if it's unpaid in your state. And all those days, and add up the hourly rate and figure out what that has cost the company and lost productivity. And in turnover, how many people at what salary were driven out by the bully? And how many people filed lawsuits and how many were settled? Call some people you know who had filed a lawsuit, and then you never heard anything about it again. That means it was settled and there was a gag order in place. Tell them you'll honor the gag order. Just tell me approximately how much money did they give you. So come up with a cash value to show how expensive this bully has actually been for the company. It's a marvelous distracting task, and you can help with it. So you distract on a family basis and do social things, and we have a distraction plan for being much more work-related. But distraction, quite frankly, is to give the person a chance to heal, let the medications work, let the investigations get done, and get the job search started for the next job, because eventually they're going to need the next job. In the end, here old the work doctor is going to give you his prescription. I'm talking about myself in third person. That's crazy and sick. This is my prescription. Number one, you need to involve or be engaged somehow as a family in stress busting. I just spent a lot of time talking about the distracting tasks, so I hope that works for you too. But stress busting is most effectively done with being physical. And so get moving and try and break up that cycle of wanting to go to bed all the time and give up and turn yourself in. So you want to try and stay active. You need to practice as a family member or friend patience and compassion. And we always hear about compassion fatigue and the rest, but I don't think there's such a thing. You have a good heart. After all, this the bully target is your loved one, so go ahead and give them some time to work things out. If the bullying is allowed to go on and no steps have ever stopped it at work, then the person is very likely to slide into a state of helplessness. It's very, very important to not adopt that mental state, but rather stay engaged. Work toward problem solving and gently guide the person, your loved one, toward problem solving. Keep them. It's very empowering to stay active in not giving up. So this is the not give up bullet, but the problem solving, it's going to take a lot of thinking of how to get out of that bind in the workplace. And that includes getting on with the next job, without a doubt. Last bullet. I've called them your loved one because I made an assumption that you actually did love them. And I hope you still love them. And I want you to rekindle your love for them and then show that love for them. For gosh sakes, be present. Don't give up on the person. They're still there. And it's being masked by stress-induced changes. The bully has invaded your life and tried to change your loved one. And you need to get hopping mad about it. The whole movement began because I got mad that a woman named Sheila dared to crawl inside my wife's head, Ruth's head, and try and tell her she was incompetent. And I'd have none of it. So you don't have to be that extreme and throw everything else away and all means of financial support and start a national movement. You can certainly join ours. You can work for enactment of our state laws to stop workplace bullying. It's called the Healthy Workplace Bill. So we invite you to do that without a doubt. You can get involved in anti-bullying related activities, but no matter what you do, just love that person and get back to the couple you once were, the family you once were, and the friendship you once had. Thank you and good luck.